During the 50s, there was a realization that behaviorism did not fully explain human learning. Although behaviorism emphasized learning that was observable and measurable, there was something missing, namely the mental events. In other words, what is going on in the mind of the learner when he or she is learning. So people were talking about, well, it was not purely looking at stimulus and how we respond to it. They wanted to know how we learned, and then simple things like particularly how we learn language. I mean, generally we all acquire language. We so easily explain from the stimulus and response answer. Cognitivists felt that it was necessary to investigate how learners make sense of what they learn. Even though such mental events are difficult to observe and measure objectively. Cognition can be defined as broadly as a process of knowing. Cognitive theories or learning focuses on the mind or the black box, an attempt to show how information is received, assimilated, stored, and recalled. However, it should be noted that unlike behaviorism, there is no single theory explaining cognition or the cognitive process or the mystery of the black box. Evidence seems to indicate that learning is a multifaceted, complex, and dynamic process. From the cognitivist perspective, learning is about systems. They consider it during like the way computers are programmed to do things. So they view it from input, and there are several forms of input. There's the visual input, the auditory inputs, the smell, the touch, the taste, and how this sensory and these sensories form short-term memory, and how some of the short-term memories are then transferred to the long-term memory. And then the link between the short-term memory and long-term memory and how we respond to a particular situation. There is a drastic shift, okay? There's a drastic shift from behaviorists who were not terribly concerned with the processes that were taking place in the so-called black box. They were only focusing on the external behavior because they believe that only those things can be observed. Now, the cognitivists are taking a bigger risk, because they are studying things that they can't see. So what they measure are external manifestation of the process that happens in the brain itself. Okay, let's go through the attributes. Okay, for example, the behavior. From a behaviorist perspective, the end in themselves, the only observable truth. So they purely look at the external behaviors and that itself the end. On the other hand, from the cognitivists, they look for evidence pointing to brain activity or brain active learning. So they are trying to see, it's harder to be a cognitivist because what they're trying to do is they're trying to relate an external behavior through a process that takes place from an unobservable position. Okay, activation of prior knowledge is irrelevant from the behaviorist perspective because we really don't care what you know before you participate in an experiment. Whereas from a cognitivist point of view, it's essential because your new knowledge is piled on to the old knowledge. So therefore, from a cognitivist point of view, when you go to class and you teach something, and you must be fully aware that if you have 20 students, all the 20 students are going to interpret what you say differently. Because they have to reconcile the new information with the old information that's already in the long-term memory, and how they have to situate the new information within the context of its old memory. It will be different because they have to interrelate with different parts of memory differently. From a behaviorist point of view, that's not relevant at all, because to them it's just repeating a particular thought behavior. So content is thought from a behavioral perspective, and it will be measured from a behavioral perspective. Now, what about teacher's role? From a behaviorist point of view, as we talked extensively just now from Thorndike and all these other perspectives, that your job as a teacher is to provide stimulus, because the student will provide the response. Learning is a response to a stimulus, right? Now, from a cognitive environment, it's slightly more complex. You have to go beyond the stimulus. You have to actually manipulate an environment, because the environment needs to give space for different learners at different stage to different stage at and different style to participate in the learning and the learning activity. So you have to create an entire ecosystem for different people to join in and play. Now, one of the greatest contributors to cognitive psychology is Piaget. That goes without saying, right? He was a Swiss psychologist that studied extensively about learning and the way mind interprets information. Now, there are two names that I will bring about. One is called Piaget, and I will call him the developmentalist. And the other person that I'll talk about is Vygotsky, that talks about social developmental. So they talk, one is measuring developmental from a personal perspective, and another is measuring it from a social perspective. So Piaget is personal development, and he came up with these four stages, the mental process, right? So he talks about the sensory motor, the pre-operational, the concrete operational, and the formal operational. So he believed that the mind had four stages of absorbing information, and the entire curricular experience should be geared from this four perspective. And the part that he even committed an age spectrum. For example, the first stage, the sensory motor, he was talking about it's been in birth to 2 years old. The pre-operational was between 2 to 7. The concrete operational was between 7 to 11, and the formal operation was from adolescent to adulthood. And if you notice the entire school curriculum, the schooling experience that he has gone through, that falls quite consistent with Piaget's personal development theory. However, many subsequent psychologists have come about and said that we should only use this as a guide and should not terribly hold on to this age barrier and this four spectrum, because there are other factors that Piaget has failed to incorporate. Second prominent cognitivist that we would like to talk about is Lev Vygotsky, a Russian psychologist. And he brought in the notion of ZPD, Zone of Proximal Development. Now, this is really crucial because he talked about cognition from a social perspective. So he was emphasizing on the theory of social cultural development rather than the personal development, because he was coming to understand the learning, particularly from the prospect of language, art, and numerical skills, where people learn most of this through participation. Now, let's talk what ZPD or ZPD is about. Now, ZPD is what, as I told you, he's taking it from the social perspective. So, it basically, in a simple one-liner, it's a distance between a student's performance with help and the student's performance independently. See, because the socially, let's say if I come in and I can naturally perform level 1, 2, and 3, and then I'm positioned in an environment that everyone is performing at level 5. So there's a gap between this zone of what I can perform at level 3 and what my environment is requiring me to perform at level 5. And so this zone between 3 to 5 prompts me to learn. Because according to Vygotsky, you will not naturally learn unless you are putting into a situation where the situation encourages you to participate and learn. That's how you learn language. You are put in a situation where your natural desire to communicate, so you pick things up. So Vygotsky's ZPD, I mean, from his perspective, it was not so much your age and how you receive ideas. It was your environment coaxing you or encouraging you to fill in the gaps. So in the process of filling in the gaps, you learn something. Now, the major difference between Piaget and Vygotsky is that Piaget believed that this knowledge emphasizing on discrete hierarchical stages of an individual. So remember the four stages that he talked, they are distinct and they are hierarchical. Whereas Vygotsky talks about modeling and guided learning. So Vygotsky was not so caught up with the chronological age. He believed that if you are put in a situation, it's a natural tendency for us to model. In the process of modeling and someone coming in to guide, learning will take place. And that's that gap that every time we fill in is called the ZPD or ZPD or called zone of proximal development. Now, on the other hand, now the biggest question one needs to ask is which came first? Because Vygotsky, Piaget talks about development. Vygotsky talks about social learning. But social learning depends on your first having to learn. Like, remember the example I was giving us just now? That the first level you have acquired 3 and then you realize the environment had 5, so therefore you participated and got the 2 more extra stages. So, but then how did the first 3 come about? So this Vygotsky and Piaget are really interrelated. You cannot split, because the individual makes up the society. The society are sum of individuals. In order to understand society, you need to understand the individual. But in order to understand the individual, you need to know the society it comes from. So, as I said, you really cannot split them and look at them as two different things, because it is basically the chicken and the egg situation. Because the individual development contributes to the social development, and the social development is contributed by the individual development. So, so society contributes to individual learners, the society itself is contributed by individual learners. I hope you get the difference. Okay, so it's like that, one of those chicken and egg kind of situations.